My name is William Dowling. I teach English and American Literature at Rutgers University in New Brunswick, New Jersey. The poem we're going to be talking about today is Robert Browning's My Last Duchess. The students whose faces you're going to see and whose voices you're going to be hearing are my regularly enrolled students in English 219. At Rutgers. We've been going for about 2.5 months now. They're all thoroughly trained in the method that we use in English 219. At the very beginning of the class, in fact, right now, I'm going to ask for their PENSA exercises. Could I have them passed left to right and down to Megan? These are Each one of these singularly is called a pensum exercise. It's a Latin word for homework. We make the class classical by calling them pensa. The plural is pensa. These play an enormously important role in the course. They consist of syntactic analysis. Poetry is hard to read very often because the grammar is hard to understand. The way the order of words in a line assigns a meaning to one word or another. The antecedent of a pronoun makes one reading possible and others impossible. They also include long sections on the Oxford English Dictionary, that great work of lexicography which gives us the English language, meanings of every word in the English language all the way back to Chaucer, all the way back to the 14th century. These students are expert in using the OED, as we call it in here. The third section of the pensum exercise is explicative paraphrase. And what I normally ask when I ask for an explicative paraphrase is just for them to use the language plain English that would make the meaning clear to a bright high school student, say, who wasn't used to reading poetry. It's a wonderful way of explaining to yourself what you think a difficult passage in a poem or a difficult line or a difficult metaphor means. Now, since what we're going to do today is going to be seen by a lot of people who aren't in English 219, I want to begin by going over the principles that underlie the method that you're going to hear put into action as soon as the students join me in discussing Browning's My Last Duchess. You should remember that the students have internalized these principles. This is what you're going to hear, something that I say at the beginning of every class, but on the first day. Now, they've internalized them. They know all about speaker and internal audience and dramatic setting and so on. This is simply for those of you who are watching, so you know what set of abstract principles underlies the method of close reading that we'll be talking about. When I teach an English 219 class for the first day, I usually start out by talking about why people come to me very often hating poetry. They hate poetry because they've had it in high school. And in high school, there are a number of reasons why poetry is incomprehensible to them, looks like word salad on the page, or perhaps looks like an excuse to say anything you want about a poem because anybody's entitled to get anything out of a poem which they want. But I have found through long experience, I've been teaching this course, some version of this course for 40 years now, that the deep source of their confusion is that they come to poetry, or they've been taught by teachers who come to poetry and try to approach it through what I call the information model of language. So the first thing we do is we dispose of the information model of language. The information model of language is briefly this, and it's a good use of language. It's something we do every day. It's a normal use of language. It's something that gets the job done for us on the street, in the dorms, in our homes, every day of the week. The problem is that it kills a poem as a poem. The information model of language is that a speaker packages a message in language, and then a listener unpacks the meaning at the other end. and a message has been passed, and the mission has been accomplished. If a poem looked like that, it would look like this, that when a poet writes a poem, an author writes a poem, he packs a message, which is a certain packet of information or sentiment, into language, and a reader, you, read it at the other end of the transaction. As I say, that's a perfectly respectable use of language. It's an indispensable use of language. But it's not appropriate to reading poetry. It ruins poetry. It doesn't allow the poem to exist as a poem. The problem is that poems aren't packets of information. They have no message. And strange as it seems, poems aren't addressed to actual readers. That's a hard one to swallow, I realize, but it's true. The big problem about the information model of language is that it ceases to exist. The poem ceases to exist as a poem if you try to apply this model. Shall we? On the first day of English 219, we get rid of that model. Now think about what the information model of language is. Think of just a simple case in which somebody's giving somebody else traffic directions. I'm out here walking on College Avenue. A motorist stops, lost, because they're not from New Jersey. They say, please tell me how to get to George Street. I say, well, you go down here, two streets, you take your first right after the second traffic light, then you take a left, and so on. If I package the information correctly, and if they understand it, they'll follow and they'll get to George Street. That's perfectly fine. If I've been accurate in my directions, the transaction has been completed. The reason that doesn't work in the case of poetry is that a poetry is not a packet of information. It's the entire world as held in the consciousness of a certain speaker. A poem is the world as held in the consciousness of a speaker. And if you want to get fancy about it, you can say that a poem exists as a poem only when it's considered as a self-contained speech act. The world is held in the consciousness of the speaker of the poem. When you do look at it that way, the poem becomes a self-contained world with its own laws, its own logic, its own center of gravity. And that's where literary study begins. That's where the study of poetry as poetry begins. It's also true of narrative and drama, but today we're concerned with poetry. Now, so the question is, usually on the first day, the question that comes up is, what happens to actual authors and actual readers, like those of us in this room? We don't have time today to go through the alternative theory that gives you the literary work as a self-contained world. It's what's called if you want to get, again, fancy about it, it's what's called the theory of literary autonomy. The idea that literature represents a different order of reality than ordinary life, and we leave ordinary life and enter literary reality, and then we come back and say what we found. But the main point is that to understand a literary work as a literary work, and in this class a poem as a poem, you've got to get rid of the author and you've got to get rid of the reader. Why? Well, one answer is that authors and speakers are never the same person. Now, the way I usually put this when I'm talking about it in the case of poetry is to appeal not to poetry but to narratives that people are familiar with. You automatically make the adjustment when you're reading a narrative, like, say, Salinger's The Catcher in the Rye. When you read The Catcher in the Rye, you know that the speaker telling the story, the voice speaking from the page, as a great literary critic named Reuben Brower put it, the voice speaking from the page is not J.D. Salinger, the author who lived up in Cornish, New Hampshire, and was a recluse and spent most of his time hiding out from the world after he became a famous author. You know that the story is being told by Holden Caulfield, a teenage boy from an upper middle class family who goes to Pensy Prep, who's deeply bothered by certain things in American civilization, and who lets his sense that there's a phoniness afoot in the world begin to disturb him in a way that adolescence amplifies or magnifies and becomes the story of Catcher in the Rye. In the same way, when you read Huckleberry Finn, you know that the story is being told by a half-educated boy who floats down the Mississippi River with Jim, his friend, on the raft, taking Jim, who's African-American, to freedom. You know that that although the author was Mark Twain, the white-haired author, famous American author who lived in Hartford, Connecticut, and was an author and lecturer, that you can't understand Huckleberry Finn unless you understand that the voice coming to you on the page is Huck. That's what we do with poems. Every poem has a speaker that's internal to the poem, or as I've said here on the board, is inside the poem. These are the words that can change your life if you let it. I sometimes think that if you teach students about to look at the speaker of the poem, you've conquered two-thirds of the resistance to poetry that has been very often inculcated them as they've encountered it in high school. But with readers, it gets a bit harder. You tend to think, you're a reader. We have classes composed of readers. Why can't the speaker inside the poem be speaking to a reader outside the poem? But think about it for a second, and you realize that there's what the philosophers call an ontological break between the speaker inside the poem and us living in the flesh and blood world in which we study poems in English 219, or our college students, or our average Americans. The fact of the matter is that no poem has a reader, an actual reader. Every poem has a dramatic audience, an audience inside the poem. Now, the internal audience never speaks, always listens, although you can tell by the back pressure being exerted on the speaker's discourse sometimes what the dramatic audience has just done. But it's always there inside the poem. In the class whose students you're about to see, we've already done a wonderful poem by Andrew Marvell called To His Coy Mistress. It's what's called a carpe diem poem. And it's about a young man who wants to get a beautiful young woman to sleep with him. And he begins by saying, had we but world enough in time, this coyness lady were no crime, would be no crime. We would sit down and think which way to pass our long love's day. Now, if anybody wants to know whom the speaker is addressing in that poem, all you have to do is point to line two and say, lady, lady, this coyness lady were no crime. And you'll suddenly realize that she belongs to the same reality as the speaker of the poem. Andrew Marvell is long since dead. He's buried in a graveyard in England. He was a 17th century poet. All the 17th century ladies he knows have been in their graves for, he knew, have, are flesh and blood ladies, are, have been in their graves for centuries. But this young, beautiful woman that the speaker is trying to seduce, or I should better say argue, into sleeping with him, is always there inside the poem and will be there in 100 years. Once you've got this axis of address, this internal speaker and talking to an audience inside the poem, you've now got 95% of what it takes to do the kind of close reading that lets you enter the poem as a self-contained reality, a world in its own right. The final element is dramatic setting. A speaker always speaks to a dramatic audience in a specific set of circumstances. In a specific set of circumstances. Now, sometimes those circumstances can be very generalized. We recently read in this 219 class, Wordsworth's wonderful little sonnet, "'Tis a beauteous evening, calm and free." Now, all you need to know to make sense of that poem is that the speaker is taking a walk on the beach at sunset with a little girl, a child, and all you need is an ocean, a shore, an adult, and a child, and a sunset, the glory of God's sunset. And you've got the dramatic setting of the poem. It not only doesn't need to be more specific than that, but it's important that it's not more specific than that. It's almost fully universalized. Today we are going to be dealing with a poem in which The speaker is an Italian nobleman of ancient lineage and a man of enormous wealth and power. The time he's speaking is in the early Renaissance, the early Italian Renaissance. He's going to be speaking to an audience internal to the poem who's going to be the subject of our discussion in class today. It's very important who that emissary is or who that audience is and how we read that audience. What we understand, what specific things, and it's in a specific setting. It's inside a Renaissance villa in a certain place in that villa with certain fixtures that have to be understood as what they are, or the poem doesn't make any sense as a poem. But I want to say something quick and dirty, give a quick and dirty account of symbolic meaning. It's this. If you want to get inside a poem, you have to figure out how the speaker is seeing the world. If you want to see how a speaker is seeing the world, you look at the symbolic language the speaker is using. Now, there are many kinds of symbolic language. Today, we're just going to mention one, metaphor. Metaphor is a counter-logical use of language. It's a statement that makes sense, no sense whatsoever on the literal level, but makes all the sense in the world on a higher level. And when you see that something makes sense but makes no sense on the literal level, you know that you're dealing with a metaphor. Now, what I try to do when I'm starting out English 219 is to convince students that this has nothing to do. I hate the notion of symbolic meaning as it's used in literature courses, where it means anything can stand for anything else, and everybody nods. And the people who are used to thinking up very weird associations generally wind up feeling that they've done the best job of interpreting it. I heard a story just this week. I heard a story. This class will remember that we went through to his coy mistress a few assignments ago, and in there the speaker says that if they had time enough, he says to the lady, if they had time enough, there would be no objection to his resisting his amorous advances. And he says, among other things, our vegetable love should grow vaster than empires and more slow. And I heard about a class elsewhere in which that was being taught, and the teacher asked what vegetable love meant, and somebody said, it obviously means an erection. And the teacher said, I beg your pardon. And the guy said, well, it's vegetable, and a zucchini is a vegetable, so you can kind of see it as a giant erection, and that is symbolic. Now, of course, it doesn't mean that, and that kind of free association, which passes for interpretation in some literary classes, is entirely irresponsible, but you've got the duty, we assume the duty in English 219 of saying why it's irresponsible to do that kind of jumping around, something reminds you of something else. And what I usually say on the first day of English 219 is this. We use metaphors all the time. We use them every day in speech. You turn in a newscast on your television set, and you hear the newscaster say, the White House announced today that the United States is going to, and so on and so forth. You've got a metaphor in your hands, and you don't even think about it. You just automatically understand what the speaker is saying. But it is a metaphor. The White House is a building. You know that in literal terms, buildings can't talk. You don't even pause to consider the literal meaning of what the speaker is saying. What you understand is that the White House here stands for a small group of policy men with enormous policy-making powers in the United States government. And bingo, you've heard a metaphor and understood a metaphor. A metaphor says that X, in this case a building, is something else Y, which in this case means a small number of people with immense policy power, making powers in the government. The standard example of metaphor in the literary handbooks used to be Spencer's wonderful line, she is the rose, the glory of the day. A guy talking about a beautiful woman. She is the rose, the glory of the day. Now, here he said that one thing, X, a flower, is another thing, a woman, a human woman. And we know what he means. We know what he means. He means, but this is where interpretation and responsible interpretation enters the picture. We know, for instance, that certain things about roses are identical, are absolutely essential to what the speaker is saying about this beautiful woman. The fragility of the rose, the beauty of the rose, the fragrance of the rose, the freshness of the rose, all those are appropriate. We know that other things about roses, that they need frequent fertilizing, that they can be eaten by Japanese beetles, that they have to be watered regularly, and so on and so forth, are completely irrelevant to what the speaker is trying to say. Interpretation, when you meet a metaphor, interpretation is a process of throwing out all the stuff that's irrelevant and seeing what is exactly relevant. And you get the meaning of the metaphor. The meaning of the metaphor is this, that at the time the speaker uses a metaphor, the resemblances between the X and the Y have become so overwhelming that the speaker has stopped seeing the differences. And thus you see how the speaker sees the world. In this case, a single woman, but you also know certain more global facts, such as the speaker is in love with this woman, the speaker is enamored of this woman, the speaker would like to glorify this woman. Okay, today we're going to be considering a poem by Robert Browning, a great Victorian poet. The speaker of the poem is, as I said in my introductory remarks, an Italian nobleman of ancient lineage. He is a monster of pride. The real drift of this poem, the movement, the direction in which it's moving is a downward spiral into the warped mind and soul and psyche of one of the most evil characters in English poetry. Browning's Duke and Shakespeare's Othello are the only two people I can think of who are quite as complicated in their evil. But he's untouchable. He's untouchable because he's got wealth, he's got power, and he's got ancestry. Now, I know some of you will have had this poem on in high school. And so you know there's a kind of surprise at the end. But I don't want anybody to jump in and say what the surprise is, because I want the people who didn't have it in high school and who don't know what the surprise is to let it dawn on them, because the fun of the poem, the great fun of the poem, is seeing how abruptly it surfaces. I do want to issue one warning before we start. And once again, this isn't for my students who already know what we're doing. But the two great curses of trying to read a poem like this now are the internet, where people go and pick up dumb, stupid stuff and try to bring it into class, and because they read it, or because somebody who seemed to be expert was writing about it, they think that's got to be part of the answer, but it never is. That's why I encourage my students never to use the internet when they're doing these things. The other evil is an old-fashioned kind of historical criticism, which tries to reduce poems like this to historical documents. So you used to be able to read that Browning based this on an actual episode in which Fernando II of Ferrara, the fifth Duke of Ferrara, had a 14-year-old wife who was a Medici, and then he married the daughter of the... None of that matters. None of that matters. None of that is inside the poem. It is true that poets sometimes get inspired by an actual episode, but then they proceed to create a world that has nothing to do with that episode. In Shakespeare's Henry V, for instance, the immortal character of Falstaff is based on an actual guy named Sir John Oldcastle, but you'll never understand Shakespeare's Falstaff better by going and looking up facts about the family history of Sir John Oldcastle. What you do is you stay inside the poem and let the poem reveal its world to you a little bit at a time. Let's take it from the top. That's my last Duchess painted on the wall, looking as if she were alive. I call that piece a wonder now. Just for the record, Jeff, what do we say about wonder?
I'm not sure.
Okay. Matt?
A magnificent thing?
Well, that's clearly what he means by it, but a wonder is technically a miracle. Signs taken for wonders. It's miraculous how good this painter was, whoever he was. We find out who he was. I call that piece a wonder now. Fra Pandolf's hands works busily a day, and there she stands. Fra. Jamie?
Prior?
Yeah, what's that mean?
I don't actually know.
You don't know? Well, you know it means friar. You know it means friar. That's cool. Anybody else get friar and find out anything about friars?
Friars are a part of a religious order?
They're a religious order, like monks and priests. They're part of a religious order. The Franciscans are friars, for instance. Now, if you enter a religious order, what's going to turn out to be important to our consideration of the poem is that if you enter a religious order, you take three vows: chastity, poverty, and obedience. Obedience is the anchor of the three. It doesn't mean that you're supposed to turn into a robot, but it does mean you're supposed to get rid of your pride, and you're supposed to be in a position to, you will do what you are told in a spirit of humility. That's what obedience means. If the abbot of the monastery tells you to go peel potatoes, you've got to go peel potatoes, and you can't resent it. Poverty means you literally can't own anything. In the monastic orders and in the friars too, literally did not own. Even the clothing they wore, which was rough serge wool and sandals, belonged to the order, not to them. You own nothing. Obviously to purge yourself of possessiveness and to live for God alone. And celibacy meant no sex of any kind ever. It was to live in a state of perpetual purity for the greater glory of God. Now, this isn't to say that there weren't friars and monks who violated their vows of chastity. In the Renaissance, Browning wrote a wonderful poem called Fra Lippo Lippi about a painter who's a monk, who also is jumping the monastery walls all the time and going out and seeing his girlfriends. But the presumption is in the favor of celibacy. If you've taken a very serious vow to God, taken your soul in your hands and said, God, I will live in a state of perpetual purity for you, the presumption is that the guy was serious when he did it. Now, why does his hands work busily a day, Alyssa?
Did he make the painting?
Hmm?
He
did paint her on the wall, but we're given much more information in the phrase work busily a day than that. That's how that picture got on the wall. And it turns out to be formidably important when you're trying to understand what this weird, twisted guy. He's not twisted yet. He's not weird yet. He hasn't started to show his weirdness. But when you start to figure out what's gone wrong here, well, let me just tell you something else. I just taught this to another class on last Thursday, and he said, I know all about that painting because there's a picture of it on the internet, and it's an oil painting of Lucrezia, somebody like that, and that's who, you know, it's a picture of that duchess. And I said, nah, it's not an oil painting, and I don't care what you saw on Wikipedia. If you believed that this was an oil painting because you saw it on the internet, it would ruin the poem entirely. We've got to concentrate with the eyes of angels on that phrase, work busily a day. And the question then, if you pose it in a somewhat different way, is this. Why did Fra Pandolf paint the picture in only one day? Is it because the Duke was a cheapskate and Fra Pandolf worked by the hour? Kenneth, what do you make of worked busily a day? Very little? Very little.
You have to paint it quickly?
The Duke is only going to keep her around for another day?
No. 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 It's what's called a fresco painting. Now I'm going to tell you about the difference between fresco painting and ordinary painting, okay? Fresco painting is done on fresh plaster. And there's good news and there's bad news about fresco painting. The good news, some of the most glorious painting of the Renaissance was done on fresco, is that you lay down a coat over what's called a scratch coat of what we now call concrete. Then you lay down a fresh coat of plaster, which is still wet. And then the painter comes in and he paints what he's going to paint. When Michelangelo did the Sistine ceiling paintings, the workman would lay a fresh coat of plaster on the part that he was going to complete that day. And he went up on the scaffolding and he was done by the end of the day. The good news about the fresco painting is that then you've got to finish it before the plaster dries. The good news about that is that if you let it dry, then it lasts forever. There are Roman fresco paintings that are 2,000 years old, which still look as fresh as day now that archaeologists have recovered. In Florence, Italy, across the river, there's a little chapel with Masaccio's wonderful painting of Adam and Eve leading the Garden of Eden. That thing's been floods, wars, everything, of course, over that, and it shows a little wear, but it's very beautiful. The bad news is that you've got to finish the painting before the plaster dries. You've got to finish the painting before the plaster dries because the dry plaster won't accept the pigment. So Fra Pandolf is really good. He's done this wondrously lifelike painting of the Duchess, but he's done it fast in a day between sunset and sunlight. He has to do it while the light is good. He would have shown up when the light about 9 o'clock, and then he would have done it by late afternoon, and then he packs up his palette and goes home. Fra Pandolf's hands work busily a day, and there she stands. Will it please you sit and look at her? Now here's the sit. You all know that I can't draw for beans, and I embarrass myself every time I try to do it. And there are numerous physical layouts that work to make sense of this poem. The one that I think is most convincing is the one that I'm about to give you. You could work it out differently, and it would still be okay. But these Renaissance villas had a mezzanine, the loggia. A mezzanine floor up here, and then they had stairs coming down. At the end of the poem, you'll hear the Duke and the person he's talking to going down to the main floor where the party is gathered that they've left for the nonce. In this case, if you picture it as a group of stairs that come down at an angle and then enter a alcove. Now this would be terracotta, it'd just be plastered walls. Usually a bench on which you sat was built right into the wall. It too was made out of stone with a colored covering, and so on. And in the back wall of the which I've drawn so ineptly, the back wall of the alcove is a picture. And over the picture, there's a brass rod with a series of rings, and there's a curtain, okay? And when you want to see the picture, he simply moves it aside. And when he says, will it please you sit, just imagine them coming down to this alcove, halfway down the stairs, and sitting down. And we've got a little poem so far that's going to be a little lesson in art appreciation, just as if you took an art appreciation course at Rutgers. There's nothing terrible that showed itself yet. But he clearly does want the person he's talking to, the internal audience, to sit and listen to what he has to say about the painting. And that's where we begin. I said Fra Pandolf by design, Megan, what's it mean?
Is he basically talking about the painting?
No, he's not. And that's the trap that the syntax lays for you. Yeah, go ahead, Yuli.
On purpose.
Because the Duke uses the word design, and this is a poem about painting, you think it has something to do with design, but it means on purpose. I said Fra Pandolf on purpose. And now we discover that he's got a purpose in this art history lesson that we're about to hear. And for never read strangers like you, that pictured countenance, the depth and passion of its earnest glance, but to myself they turned, since none puts by the curtain I have drawn for you, but I. I want to look at the little buried metaphor, red. I think because we've got insets of all this that I'm going to use the board. Is that okay, Dan?
Sure.
Megan, what's a countenance?
Isn't it like a facial expression?
Facial expression. Now, how can you read a facial expression? Why is that a metaphor? Why didn't it strike you as a metaphor? Scott?
Well, because if you read something, it usually has words on it, and someone's facial expression.
Well, you can read a lot of things that aren't words, but the process is exactly the same as when you do read words. Now, watch what happens. What you're being alerted to is the fact that what the metaphor alerts you to is the fact that your face is just made of stuff. It doesn't occur to us that often. But it's just made of muscles and bones and nerves and blood vessels and skin and so on and so forth. It's just a mass of physical stuff, like silly putty. You can't read silly putty. What we're less likely to think about is that writing just consists of stuff, just physical material. And the Duke's playing on that. I'm going to write something on the board, and I'm going to ask Alyssa, no, I'm going to ask Jeff, because he's got a good, clear voice. I'm going to ask Jeff to pronounce it as loudly and distinctly as he can. Now, this is just going to be a bunch of chalk marks on a board. Can you pronounce that clearly and distinctly?
No.
No. Now I'm going to make another bunch of chalk marks on a board. The chalk is going to detach from the thing I'm writing in. Can you pronounce that?
Can.
There we go. You see, reading means taking the physical chalk marks on the board and, so to speak, looking through it to something else, which is the meaning of the word, right? Okay, what are you doing when you read a countenance, Matt?
I'm reading into maybe what emotions that countenance is having.
You're looking right through the fat cells and the skin and so on and so forth, and you're seeing into the mind of somebody else, the state of mind or state of consciousness, right? And that's important to what the Duke is saying. He's saying there's not just a picture here, or there's not just a picture even of a countenance, but they're looking, going, passing right through it and seeing a state of mind which they assume to be there, right? Now, what that state of mind is highly ambiguous. You're going to find out that it probably would be one thing to us, but it's something else to the Duke, and he's mad about it. I mean, it makes him angry. I said Frau Pandolf by design, for never read strangers like you that pictured countenance, the depth and passion of its earnest glance. But to myself they turn, since none puts by the curtain I have drawn for you but I. And seemed as they would ask me if they durst, how such a glance came there, durst. Kenneth.
Dare?
Why wouldn't they dare ask him? Seems like an innocuous question. Innocent enough.
Hmm? Because they think he'll get angry?
You've got to picture somebody else sitting with him, other people on previous occasions sitting with him on this bench, and he draws back the curtain and you see this beautiful young woman, and they turn to him, and he knows in his twisted mind what they would like to ask him, and then they turn away because they realize that they might get in trouble for asking the question they were about to ask. Do you all know what a cuckold is? What's a cuckold, Scott?
A man whose wife is cheating on him.
A man whose wife is cheating on him, and everybody in town knows it except him, right? Now we begin to see that he's off the deep end. Now I'm going to read it slowly, and you tell me where the weirdness comes from. Never read strangers like you that pictured countenance, the depth and passion of its earnest glance, but to myself they turned, since none puts by the curtain I have drawn for you but I. And seemed as they would ask me if they durst how such a glance came there. So, not the first are you to turn and ask thus. Matt, where's the weirdness coming from?
First of all, I think the curtain, the fact that he's saying that only...
No, leave the curtain for a minute. So, not the first are you to turn and ask thus.
He didn't even ask him.
Nobody's asked anything. This is all happening in the guy's head. This is all happening in the guy's head. So, not the first of you to turn and ask this. We already see that the guy's in a psychodrama of his own construction. He's playing out. He's playing out a script that nobody else knows about except him. Just for the record, Alyssa, what about puts by?
Pulls aside.
Yeah. On this. He just shoves those brass rings holding it on the rod and exposes the picture. Since none puts by, draws back the curtain I have drawn for you but I, and seemed, take the as meaning as if, or as if they wanted to ask me, if they dared, how such a glance came there. Sir, and we find out something important about internal audience here. It's a single male. Sir. As soon as you say that, and of a social status that the Duke has to respect. He wouldn't have used this register of address to a servant, saying, so, sir, another male, and somebody of, in the vicinity of his own social status, though not equal to him. Sir, 'twas not her husband's presence only called that spot of joy into the Duchess' cheek. What's the spot of joy? Go ahead, Jamie.
A blush of pleasure.
Yeah, good for you. Exactly so. Now, I want you to watch the blush, because all that happens physiologically when you blush is she's just a shy young girl. She just, when she's complimented, she blushes. She doesn't know how to take a compliment. All that happens when you blush is that blood comes up from this area and comes into your cheeks and then goes back. We're going to watch that blush a little bit as the scene develops. But when he says, "Sir, 'twas not her husband's present only called that spot of joy into the Duchess' cheek," this is the spot of joy in the picture on the wall. She's been painted blushing or having just blushed. But what does his say? What does his saying, "'Twas not her husband's presence only," tell us about him? Go ahead, Jamie.
That other man made her blush too, and he was jealous about it, even though it wasn't.
No, no. Let me say something, because this poem is deliberately misleading at the beginning. I mean, the Duke is deliberately misleading because he's a misleader. There is going to be a conventional language of sexual jealousy at the beginning of the poem. We've already seen it in "If They Durst," and "Call That Spot of Joy," and so on and so forth. By the end of the poem, we're going to find out that this son of a bitch is jealous of anything, that any appreciation that's by the woman, his duchess, that is not directed to himself. He's going to be jealous of sunsets. He's going to be jealous of mules. He's going to be jealous of... She's a beautiful, innocent young thing. When people do nice things to her, she blushes. But he thinks that her husband's presence is the only thing in the universe that should call forth that spot of joy. "Sir, 'twas not her husband's presence only, that you could understand. Me, I'm the center of the world. If she'd blushed when I came into the room with pleasure, that would be perfectly normal and wonderful, but she didn't do that." She didn't do that. "Sir, 'twas not her husband's presence only called that spot of joy into the Duchess' cheek. Perhaps Fra Pandolf chanced to say, 'Her mantle laps over my lady's wrist too much.'" Now, why would that call forth a blush? Think about it now. You've got a painter who's painting this beautiful young woman, richly dressed in the Renaissance. Go ahead, Jamie.
He's telling her to show a little more skin.
Jamie, yes. Jamie, yes. Yes, good, Jamie. The thing about it, Jamie, is that I'd like to preserve something of the delicacy of the scene here. I mean, if Frau Pandolf was saying, "Hey, babe, show us a little more skin, would you?" It wouldn't exactly fit the delicate currents and cross currents that we're imagining. If you put it into the language of courtesy, what's a mantle?
A shawl.
A shawl, yeah. It's a wraparound, very rich. This would be embroidered. Perhaps Fra Pandolf, what's chanced mean, Matthew?
Fra Pandolf, possibly meant to.
Well, that does it, but what would we say just in plain English?
He happened to.
Happened to say. Perhaps Fra Pandolf happened to say, her mantle laps or my lady's wrist too much. He would have said that to her in the third person, by the way, that way. Her mantle laps or my lady's wrist too much. He wouldn't say, "Hey, your mantle's over your wrist too much, lady, take it back." What? Work that out to a compliment for me, the most delicate and indirect of courtly compliments without getting any skin in it. If Fra Pandolf had said that, and she had taken it in a certain way, and blushed, how would she have taken it? How do we explain the blush? Scott?
She took it as him saying she is more beautiful than the clothes she's wearing.
You've got a beautiful, delicate wrist. Why hide it with cloth? I can paint cloth all the time, but you're just... But do you see how indirect it is and how graceful it is and how unlibidinous it is? Perhaps Fra Pandolf chanced to say, "Her mantle laps over my lady's wrist too much." Or Perhaps he chanced to say, paint must never hope to reproduce the faint half-flush that dies along her throat. Explain the kind of the faint half-flush that dies along her throat. Well, it's dyes that give you the metaphor. Jeff, got it?
Well, dyes is to furnish with a dye, and the half-flush would be the blood that was in, that came from her throat that went up to her face.
Attaboy. Attaboy. Do you understand that what he's giving you is two blushes here? She says one thing, and he blushes. The blood begins to go back down to where it was, and then as it's dying, that is to say, her complexion is returning to normal. The blood is receding down her cheeks. He says, paint must never hope to reproduce. It's so delicate and so pure that the greatest painter in the world couldn't capture the translucence and the beauty of it. And she blushes again, of course. Huh? Huh? Such stuff was courtesy, she thought, and cause enough for calling up that spot of joy. Courtesy has a technical meaning here. It means the behavior of courtiers, men to women, in the Renaissance. The great background of this work is a wonderful work called Il Cortegiano, The Book of the Courtier, by Castiglione, in which there's an elaborate code of compliment and appropriate behavior on the part of women, appropriate compliment on the part of the men, all supposedly platonic. She had a heart, how shall I say, too soon made glad, too easily impressed. Why does he say, how shall I say? Is he really inarticulate? He seems to be doing all right, doesn't he? I mean, he's been talking in rhymed pentameter for... ...20 or so lines now. But he's trying to make a point. He's trying to make a point by saying that, how shall I say? How shall I say? How shall I say? We've got to figure out what the point is. Okay, Matt?
Perhaps that he's trying to make it seem like he's thinking of a more civil thing to say.
Yeah, that's it. That's it. This is in formal rhetoric, this is called praeter ideo, which means saying something by saying that you're not going to talk about it. If a politician were to say, it would be greatly below me to even mention my opponent's well-known sexual proclivities for, no, I will not mention it. It would be too, I can't, no, I will not, leaving, of course, the audience to imagine the worst. Sir, 'twas all one. Megan, 'twas all one. Paraphrase.
It were to be a single thing.
No.
Everything was viewed as the same.
It was all the same to her. It was all the same to her. New Jersey English, right? Hey, it was all the same to her. She didn't care. It was all the same to her. She liked whatever she looked on, and her looks went everywhere. Search was all one. She gave everything the same importance. My favor at her breast. Favor is part of an older language of courtesy. What did the OED tell you about favor? Alyssa.
That it's something that you give to a lover that they're supposed to.
That's perfect. It's a gift from a man to a woman to indicate love. There are many things that this could be. I always picture it as a silk handkerchief, probably. It was not immodest for women to wear low-cut gowns in the Renaissance. Décolletage, it's called. And to give her a silk handkerchief would have been a very... To tuck it down it's consistent with the modesty of the Duchess here. Silk was incredibly expensive. It was, at the time of Queen Elizabeth, a pound of silk was worth much more than a pound of gold. And that's roughly the time we're getting towards in this poem. My favorite at breast. The last meaning of favor that tells you what it means in this poem in modern English is, did you ever go to, or did your mother ever give you a birthday party when you were a little kid and they put out party favors? That sense of a gift in a ceremonial context is the last survival of the word that I know. Okay. She liked whate'er she looked on, and her looks went everywhere. Search was all one, my favorite at breast. the dropping of the daylight in the west. Alyssa?
Sunset.
Yeah, he's now jealous of sunsets? He's now jealous of sunsets. The sun shouldn't do that. You know, or maybe the sun could do it, but she shouldn't pay any attention to it. She says, oh, what a beautiful sunset. And she's in trouble. She's in deep trouble. The bough of cherries some officious fool broke in the orchard for her. This is hard. Officious, Jamie.
Unduly forward and offering his services, kind of like butting in where
you're going. That's exactly right. Now, you know, this is a case where I found that the OED definition doesn't do justice to what the guys kind of say. Somebody who's officious in modern life is maybe at a hotel. A guy says, what can I do for you, sir? Would you like me to order a bellboy? And you just want to be left alone. You want to get up to your room and have a drink. You know, you say, and can we get this for you when our dining room opens, and so on and so forth. Here he's seeing somebody who's doing something courteous and normal in the social world of this poem as being officious, unduly forward, busybody. What would have happened is that this would be a neighboring nobleman or somebody of equal social rank who came to visit the family, and the family isn't up yet. So the servants show him out into the garden behind the villa. The cherries are in bloom, and he breaks off a branch of flowers to take to his hostess as a compliment. And the Duke hates this. Now, you're supposed to do this. In Germany, you have to do it. If you go to a dinner party, it's called a Mitbringsel, and you're supposed to bring fresh flowers to your hostess, and it goes back to this earlier custom. But why does he call the guy a fool? Why does he have a specific person in mind?
No, but I think he's making up intentions in his head, like assuming that, because he's in his own world and he keeps making up these things about how the woman's feeling.
He does. So anybody who did this would be a fool. He hates anybody who does it. They're all, I can't say the language I would normally use in English 219 because we're shooting this for posterity. But the wonders of post-production are numerous. So let me just say, he considers anybody who would bring his wife flowers an asshole. Okay, let's go back to Frau Pandolf for a second now. He was imagining that that she was getting it on with the painter. Was the Duke in the room when Frau Pandolf painted that picture? Well, I want an answer, yes or no. And I want syntactic evidence for it. Was the Duke in the room when Frau Pandolf's hands worked busily a day, and how do we know that? Kenneth?
No, because he says he's not certain if he complimented her.
What's the word that tells you he wasn't
chanced.
In the room? Huh?
Chanced?
No.
Perhaps.
That's not bad, though, by God. Chanced would do it. There's a stronger...
Perhaps.
If he has to say perhaps, he does. He wasn't in the room. If he wasn't in the room, he's imagining the whole scene. Now we realize we're in the head of this Duke. Now, let's consider the possibility, which he's clearly entertaining, that she's coming on to the painter. According to the circumstances, the concrete circumstances of the dramatic setting. What do we know about Frau Pandolf? Well, we know he was in holy orders and he took a vow of celibacy. It's unlikely that he's trying to get it on with the patron of a paint. Second of all, he's painting very fast. And you have to paint very fast on wet plaster, right? Like that. Third of all, it's virtually impossible that somebody she's seen, he does this between sunset and sunrise and sunset for the light. To paint the fresco painting, it's extremely unlikely that a heavy romance could develop in that time, even if the guy weren't a friar and in religious orders, and even if the guy weren't painting as fast as he could. This is the Duke in his own head. We now see him standing fully exposed as somebody who's living his own psychodrama. Sir, it was all one, my favorite her breath, the dropping of the daylight in the west, the bough of cherries. Some officious fool broke in the orchard for her. the white mule she rode with round the terrace, all and each would draw from her alike the approving speech, or blush at least. Okay, let's look at that white mule. It speaks volumes about the Duke's relation to the Duchess. God, it really does. What do you make of the whiteness of the mule is the question. Why are mules white? What is a mule? Let us consider the mule. David Foster Wallace wrote a book called Consider the Lobster. We're gonna answer that with Consider the Mule. What is a mule? Nobody knows what a mule is. You know what a mule is.
It's half donkey, half horse, right?
Mm-hmm. What combination? Has to be, doesn't it have to be a male donkey and a female horse? Yeah. Yeah. How do mules get to be white? They're usually not white. They're usually gray or dun or...
Albino, maybe? I don't know.
Yeah, albino is one possibility, or the other is you can breed for them, but they're very rare. But this guy has gone out. They're very expensive. Very expensive. But this guy has gone out and bought a white mule for his wife to ride around the terrace of the villa. The villa would be built up on a hillside, and there would be a flat terrace in front of it with stone railings and stuff to keep people from falling off. How do I know that there's a cart in the scene, by the way? How do I know that the mule is pulling a cart? It's the word with. She isn't riding on the mule, she's riding with the mule, which means the mule has to be pulling the cart. The white mule belongs to an ancient language of courtesy. It goes all the way back to Arthurian romance. You can see it when associated with a woman, it is always a sign of the woman's purity and chastity. Now, chastity has nothing to do with sex as such. It can mean sexual fidelity to a husband. You remember in Penshurst that the speaker says, "Thy lady's noble, chaste withal." Do you remember that? She's had a lot of kids. Fruitful, chaste withal. In Spenser's Faerie Queen, the great allegory written by Shakespeare's contemporary Edmund Spenser, when you open up book one, you meet somebody called the Red Cross Knight, and there's a lady who figures largely in the story. Her name is Una, and she's riding across the landscape on a white mule. And if you go back into Mallory and the Arthurian romances, you'll find the same thing. Now, the kicker here is that the white mule, because of its rarity, is extremely expensive as a gift. The husband here, the Duke, gave it to his wife as a symbol of her purity and innocence, and so on. And now he's jealous of his own gift. She thanked men good, but thanked somehow, I know not how, as if she ranked my gift of a 900 years old name with anybody's gift. She thanked men good, but thanked somehow, I know not how, as if she ranked my gift of a 900 years old name with anybody's gift, like the bough of cherries that some officious fool brought from the orchard, presumably. Notice the Praetor Ideo there, I know not how, he's doing the same thing. I have not skill in speech, he'll say later. He's gesturing towards a multiplicity of terrible things that he just doesn't know how to find language for. But his saying that she ranked my gift of a 900 years old name with anybody's gift tells us how he saw her and why he's mad, or why he was angry, why he was driven to distraction by this woman's behavior. And it's when he calls his name a gift to her. How's he seeing her? And how do we know that? Kenneth?
He sees her as lucky to be with him.
She sure is. Why? 900 years means 900 years of consecutive patrilinear succession. I mean, 9 centuries of father to son, father to son, father to son. And in those European families, they really did do this. They really had this pride of ancestry. To have an unbroken line of succession for 9 centuries was a massively important social fact. It was just incredible. It outweighed practically everything else like that. But it also says how he saw her. Alyssa, how do you see her?
Doesn't he see himself as being more superior because...
More superior? superior. Oh, God. Mountaintop more superior than the plains below.
Yes, but...
You see how you got to read this backwards? I gave my name to her. I made... Jamie.
He thinks that she's really simple for not valuing her social elevation.
She was a nobody. I plucked her out of the gutter. Who'd stoop to blame this sort of trifling? Even had you skill in speech, which I have not, to make your will quite clear to such a one and say just this or that in you disgusts me. Here you miss or there exceed the mark. And if she let herself be lessened so, nor plainly set her wits to yours forsooth and made excuse, even then would be some stooping, and I choose never to stoop. Okay, we take it that far. Just for the record, Megan, trifling?
Like jesting, frivolous talk.
Light jesting, frivolous behavior, perfect. Even had you skill in speech, which I have not. Now that's the third case of prior idio. I don't have any skill in speech, the set off by dashes, which I have not. This guy is trying to say a lot by saying that he's not gonna say. He doesn't have the language to say what he wants to say. But in this case, which I have not, is supposed to send a message to. Why does he say he doesn't have, besides the prior idio reason, that he wants to imply much more than he says, he wants to imply much more by saying that he can't quite express what he means, leaving you to imagine the rest. Can anybody imagine why he would take actual pride in not having skill in speech? This is hard. You've got to know some, you need to know a little bit of social history to understand what's going on here. The thing is that, believe it or not, oh yeah, Jeff, go ahead.
I was just saying, is it because he doesn't really need the skill since he's so powerful? And
that's exactly it. You are great. You are great. That is exactly it. Aristocrats didn't have to be articulate or eloquent. They hired people to do that for them. You hired people to do everything for you. You just sort of were there, being 900 years old. The only modern parallel I can think of this is something like a contemporary court of law. If you were in trouble and the facts seemed to be against you, you try to hire a very good lawyer to speak for you in law, because they're going to speak a language in that courtroom that you don't understand. And no matter how smart you are and how good you are at drawing conclusions, you couldn't represent yourself as well as. That was the aristocrats' version. Most aristocrats in the Middle Ages couldn't read, by the way, and they were proud of that. Charlemagne did learn to read. He never did learn to write. So he's both asserting aristocratic pride and doing prior idio there. It's a lovely double resonance. Even had you skill in speech, which I have not, to make your will quite clear to such a one, and say just this or that in you disgusts me. Here you miss, or there exceed the mark. Disgusts is an older meaning. Did anybody hear a bell go off and look it up? Jamie did.
A strong distaste for?
Yeah. Right now it's a yuck word. It really disgusts me, but it means to inspire displeasure in somebody, to inspire displeasure in somebody. Gustare means to taste in Latin, and then the prefix dis negates that. And just this or that in you disgusts me. He doesn't mean it in in the modern yuck way. He means it, I got to keep my language at the G level here. What do they do for film ratings? What's the one you can take little kids to? Is that G? Yeah, okay, we're gonna do a G audience. Here you miss or there exceed the mark, it's a metaphor. What's the mark, Alyssa?
I'm not entirely sure, but I thought it was supposed to represent the behavior that's expected from a wife.
It is, exactly, but that's telling me what the metaphor means. Now it's wonderful because you know what the metaphor means. Now tell me how missing the mark gives you that meaning. What is it to do literally? Remember what we just said. You guys don't have to go back to day one. A metaphor is something that makes literal nonsense. The lady is not a rose, she's not a flower, but makes sense at a higher level, so you have to interpret what it is. Now, yes, it missing the mark means if he had talked to his wife this way and said, look, your behavior is really unacceptable. It's the, you know, it's a little bit of this and a little bit of that, and you've got to be more careful about this, and don't look quite so appreciative when some officious fool brings you a bough of cherries from the orchard, for God's sake, and when they bring the white mule up, don't blush, please, and so on and so forth. We understand that, but missing the mark has a metaphor buried there. And if you understand what the metaphor is, you understand how precise this guy would have her be if he could just press a button and do it. So we need simply to know what a mark is literally. What is it?
Is it a target?
Yeah, it's a target. It's a bullseye. And what he's saying is hitting the bullseye would be to hit the mark. If you miss the mark, you just miss it off to either side. If you exceed it, you go over the target completely, right? And he's saying, even if you had skill in speech to say just this or that and you disgust me, here you miss. You're in the vicinity, lady, my dear. You're in the vicinity, my dear, but you're just a little bit wide of the bullseye. They'll be a little less appreciative. Be a little less appreciative. Here you miss. Or there, exceed the mark. Sometimes she just flies right over. She thanks the guy who brings her flowers from the back garden. You know, wow, that's off the wall. Just this or that and you disgust me, here you miss or there exceed the mark. And if she let herself be lessened so, nor plainly set her wits to yours forsooth and made excuse, even then would be some stooping, and I choose never to stoop. If she let herself be lessened so, paraphrase Yuli.
If she let herself be instructed by him.
If she sat still for being instructed in the way that it would require to get her behavior within the parameters of acceptable behavior, okay? If she let herself be lessened so, nor plainly set her wits to yours forsooth, and made excuse, gave you excuses about how you didn't mean anything by it. Is everybody with me every word, by the way? The poem perfectly pellucid. All right. Even then would be some stooping, and I choose never to stoop. Even then would be some stooping. Stooping, Megan?
Like to degrade oneself?
Yeah, to degrade himself, to lower himself. Why would it? Now, this is, now we are really into this guy's head at this point, and it's really something to be down here. It's getting grimy. Why would it be stooping, lowering himself, to reason with her about the behavior that displeases him? He is her husband, Scott.
Because she should already know what's expected of her.
She should already know it, yeah. He thinks any wife of his should already know it. But that's Jeff, do you see it?
I think it goes back to the superiority complex where he knows that he's better than her, so he feels that she should just be doing whatever he wants her to do, and there's really no other way around it.
And if he has to order her or tell her about it, he comes down, it's a form of pleading with her to change her behavior.
And
he shouldn't have to do that. Now go back to the Fra Pandolf scene. He wasn't in the room when Fra Pandolf was painting the painting. Why wasn't he in the room if he's so bloody jealous all the time and he wanted to see what was going on? He could have built up his case against her. He would have remembered actual things that Fra Pandolf said. But he wasn't there. Why wasn't he there?
He felt that if he obliged his thoughts to confront her about anything that he thought, would be degrading to himself.
And I choose never to stoop. Even to be there and watching like a hawk while she was alone with his painter would be showing that he was capable of this kind of jealousy. Now, it's not sexual jealousy anymore. It's sunsets and mules and charities and so on and so forth. It's anything but his monstrous pride. He's the center of the universe. 900 years old, name, lineage, power, wealth. And she treats him just like her husband, but as though other things could possibly be equally important. He chooses never to stoop. He chooses never to stoop. I choose never to stoop. Those are the most menacing words English poetry sometimes, I think. Notice the vaingloriousness of that I choose never to stoop. The one thing that's left to me, the one form of action, is that I don't have to lure myself. I've got everything else in the world, and if I refuse to stoop, I have everything in the world. I am the world. And then there's this. Oh, sir. She smiled, no doubt, when he or I passed her. But who passed without much the same smile? This grew. I gave commands. Then all smiles stopped together. There she stands, as if alive. Will it please you rise? This, in the phrase, this grew. I almost don't want to ask for an antecedent here. There is an antecedent, but it's a kind of weird kind of antecedent. Jamie, what do you think?
Her smiling at everyone?
It's the entire range of behavior described in the earlier lines, okay? This grew. What does grew mean?
It got worse.
It got worse. She was paying more and more attention. What was really happening? Yuli. Was she changing her behavior? Was this becoming markedly more pronounced on her part, this showing appreciation to anything that moved in her vicinity? Was she really going downhill, Jeff?
It's not that she was changing. It was that he was finally starting to realize that what she was doing.
Well, he was getting more and more obsessed about it. He was just becoming more and more. It wasn't growing. It was growing in his mind. It was taking over his entire psyche. That's the point. We have every reason to assume in the poem that her behavior remains absolutely unchanged, but he started fastening on it more and more and noticing more and more things and becoming more and more incensed at this behavior. This grew. This grew. I gave commands. Then all smiles stopped together. Alyssa.
I think he means that he was giving her commands, so she stops. I'm not sure. It's
yeah,
like
no,
all
it's
smiles,
it's
so it has to be the smiles that she gives to him and to everyone else. So.
Mm-hmm. Now, there are very many ways that they could cease. Jamie, what?
I think he had her killed.
He had her killed. That's a surprise that every high school teacher knows. He had her killed. He had her put away. He had her poisoned. He wants another duchess now. That's why the last at the beginning of the poem implies a next now. He had her killed. Why didn't he do it himself? Why didn't he just poison her bedtime posset, which is a cup of warm wine with a...
He doesn't stoop. I don't know.
He doesn't stoop. He didn't do that. He hires guys to do it. He gave orders to a couple of bully boy servants, and they took her out and drowned her in a fish pond. And you can imagine anything you want. But you mess around with this guy, he'll give commands, and then all smiles will stop together. Do you see how they stop to listen? Yeah. Yeah. This grew, I gave commands, then all smiles stopped together. There she stands as if alive. Back at the picture. Will it please you rise? We'll meet the company below then. Now he's speaking for the first time directly to the internal audience of the poem. And we find out everything about the poem, everything about where this person has been with the Duke, what they've been doing, and what they're there for. We'll meet the company below then. That means downstairs. They're waiting. The count and his party is what the what. We'll meet the company below then. I repeat, the count, your master's known munificence is ample warrant that no just pretense of mine for dowry will be disallowed, though his fair daughter's self, as I avowed at starting, is my object. Nay, we'll go together down, sir. Notice Neptune, though, taming a seahorse, thought a rarity. Which claws of Innsbruck cast in bronze for me? Dowry. Let's just get it wrapped up so that everybody's clear. We make sure everybody's clear. No, Jamie, you've been carrying too much of the work for this. Matt, what's a dowry?
The dowry is the money or property a wife brings her husband.
It is. The property or money that a wife brings with her husband upon a new marriage. So, what have these two guys, the Duke and whoever he's talking to, been talking about upstairs?
They've probably been making negotiations about the marriage.
His next duchess. His next duchess. These aristocratic marriages were like the mating, like the joining of two countries. There were millions of legal details that had to be settled. Details of inheritance, details of who got what lands, what happened if the wife died before the husband, what happened if the husband died before the wife, and so on and so forth. All that had to be negotiated. And that's what they've been doing. Up in his business office on the second floor of the villa, they've been talking about the dowry arrangements for the woman that he now proposes to marry, his next duchess, who is the daughter of a neighboring count. Why doesn't he get up there, light a cigar, and say, "Count, you got a lot of money, I got a lot of money, you got a lot of land, I've got a lot of land. Why don't we divvy it up by rolling the dice? The dice, Ada from Decatur, and the baby needs new shoes." No, he's talking to somebody else. Why?
Well, the messenger that he's talking to is probably deals with all the legal issues.
That's great. The messenger is usually what would be called a bailiff or steward who would manage an estate for a great man. All the rents, the tenancies, the income, and so on and so forth. There's another rule hanging around in the background, which is that aristocrats don't talk about money. That would be stooping, and he chooses never to stoop. This used to be an older rule in America. I remember when I was growing up, my parents never talked about money in front of the children. It was regarded as... Now, everybody talks about nothing but what their last car cost, or their car cost, or their last house cost, or what their neighbor's house cost, or whatever. But in this days, money was unmentionable. So you did it through intermediaries. So this is an intermediary. We usually call him in our class the emissary that has been sent by the neighboring duke. I repeat, the count, your master's known munificence is ample warrant that no just pretense of mine for dowry will be disallowed. That's a big mouthful, but can we just get it into plain English for the people, for the lookers in? Munificence means what, Scott?
Great generosity.
Great generosity, yeah. Alyssa, you want to do it? Is it too hard? It's not hard, it's just clumsy, isn't it?
Yeah.
your count is so notoriously generous a man that I realize that any reasonable request that I make for a dowry is something that he'll accept immediately without a lot of haggling. Okay? Nay, we'll go together down, sir. Notice Neptune, though, taming a seahorse, thought a rarity which Claus of Innbrook cast in bronze for me. Now, I had a little seahorse drawn, but what he's doing is he's coming full circle to the art appreciation lesson theme of the poem. It started out with the showing of a picture, and it ends with his showing a bronze statuette, which would be on a pedestal in the corner of the alcove that we're talking about, and he says, "Let them." It's commonly said in the poem that Neptune, the Roman god of the sea, symbolizes the duke's own sense of superiority, taming a seahorse in relation to any wife he's going to marry. Claus of Innsbruck is an imaginary sculptor, just as Fra Pandolf, at the beginning of the poem, is an imaginary painter. They live in this poem. Now, think about what we know about the internal audience of this poem, and think about how this strange lesson in art history has altered his perception of the world, such that he's going to take a certain message back to the count, his master, when they talk the next day. And keep in mind that the duke has been indirect, has disguised what he has to say, the message he wants to get across as an art history, art appreciation lesson, precisely because what he's done is monstrous. He's just confessed to a murder, but you can't put somebody in jail for giving a lesson in art appreciation. He gives good credit to the, he gives a lot of credit to the emissary, the steward, the bailiff, because he realizes Why does he say, will it please you rise? That's courteous language to an inferior. This guy would be something like a lawyer, the family lawyer or barrister or something like that. But still, he's close enough to the in social rank to the Duke that you use courteous language to him. Will it please you rise? Not stand up, chump, but will it please you rise? Why does he say that when he says that? You're late.
It kind of seemed abrupt the way he stopped.
It is abrupt. Why is it abrupt? We better explain the abruptness.
He says, then all smiles stop together, and there.
What's he just seen on the emissary's face? Then all smiles stop together. What's he seen, Matt?
I guess kind of a shocking realization.
Yeah, the guy's gotten the message. The lesson is over. We're going to go downstairs now. Will it please you rise? Will it please you rise? You see how the abruptness? The emissary is going, will it please you rise? I repeat, the Count, your master's known munificence is ample warrant that no just pretense of mine for dowry will be this allowed. Nay, we'll go together down, sir. That's the last important interaction between the speaker and the internal audience, and it tells you everything about what's just been accomplished. And then we'll talk about how you finally come into a three-dimensional understanding of the emissary's role in this poem, and everything will tie itself together, and you'll see why Browning's To His Last Duchess has always been accounted a very great poem. When he says something has just happened, some physical event, series of physical movements has happened when he says, nay, we'll go together down, sir. This means that second flight of stairs that I was talking about down from the alcove. What has the emissary just done to prompt a nay? No. Nay means no, we'll go together down, sir. What's just happened? This is easily messed up, you know.
Is he trying to get away from him? Seeing
no, us? No. Quite the reverse. Put yourself in the place of an emissary, knowing about this man's monstrous prize. You both stood up from the bench, that banco that I talked about at the beginning, and it's time to go down. What's the next thing you're going to do? Yeah, I think it's hard to see. Jeff.
Would it be the opposite of what I just said and let him go first since he's the more important?
You step back and you let him go first. You don't precede a duke with a 900 years old name going down the stairs, right? But this guy, in a tremendously democratic moment, says, no, we'll go down together, means side by side. Nay, don't step back from me. We'll go together down, sir. Why does he do that? No, he sees that the guy's gotten his message, and it will be a faithful transmitter of his message to the Count. I repeat, the Count, your master's known munificence is ample warrant that no just pretense of mine for dowry will be disallowed, though his fair daughter's self, as I avowed at starting, is my object. Nay, we'll go together down, sir. Notice Neptune, though taming a seahorse, thought a rarity which Claus of Innsbruck cast in bronze for me. Now, when the emissary steps back and the Duke says, no, we'll walk down side by side, what he's doing is saying, you understand me, I understand you. I have no further business to transact with you. Now I want you to cast your minds back to the... I want you to cast your minds back to the beginning of the poem. Is this the first time that the Duke has ever dealt with an emissary from a neighboring nobleman in quest of a new wife? Why not, and how do we know that? Jamie?
Because he has a last duchess, so he's done it at least once before.
No, I don't mean that. I'm saying since his last duchess died, has this little scene that we've just seen where you sit down, you look at the picture, he, through the most oblique and indirect means possible, admits that what he does to a wife who insufficiently appreciates him. Is this the first time that he started to look for a new wife or not? Alyssa?
I think I don't think so because of the strangers he mentioned before.
Yeah, why? Say it loud. Say it clear. Say it loud. Say it so that you can be heard.
Because of the strangers he mentioned earlier in the poem.
Yeah. Give us the line that tells us that he's gone through this many times.
I said, Frau Pandolf, by design, for never read strangers like you that pictured countenance, the depth and passion.
Never read strangers like you that pictured countenance, but to myself they turn since none puts by the curtain I have drawn for you but I, right? He's the only, he's given us two essential pieces of information. He's the only guy in this villa who ever gets to move that. And strangers sitting on a bench beside him have gone through exactly this transaction with him numerous other times. The word never argues a certain multiplicity of previous events. You see what I'm saying? Okay, so the question is, if he's been through this transaction numerous times, daughters of neighboring noblemen with big dowries and all the rest of it, and so on, why does he keep it up? Why does he keep it up? Now put yourself in the head of the emissary going back to his master, the count, tomorrow. The master takes him up to the business office and said, how'd the negotiations go yesterday when you were talking to the Duke? Should my daughter marry him or not? Now put yourself in the head of the emissary and say what you would say to the count, your master. Scott, what would you say?
I mean,
it's pretty weird, isn't it?
Yeah, I think I would say maybe you shouldn't give your daughter over to this guy.
Wouldn't what?
Give your daughter over to this guy because he killed his last wife.
Well, but look, if this guy thinks that every father is going to say, whoops, it means a dead daughter, why does he keep going? Why does he keep asking people? Why does he keep going through this macabre ritual? He's going to keep going till he finds what he wants. So what the emissary has to realize is that the count's daughter better be what this guy wants. And he's got to explain it to his master in very precise terms. This is where internal audience becomes absolutely crucial to understanding the poem. We've got to do all this ourselves, but the poem has made it absolutely inevitable that the emissary the next day will say what needs to be said to his count, the master. Matthew?
That your daughter better be willing to do whatever the Duke wants, or else she'll probably be killed.
Look, your daughter can marry this guy, but she better be prepared to treat him like he is the sun of her universe, to pay exclusive attention to him, to pay exclusive attention to nobody or anything else, to not make him feel as though he has been at all lured in by her behavior towards him. He has to be the cynosure of all eyes. And if she can do it, then go ahead and let her marry him. That'll be fine. Dowries are fine. Melding the estates is probably practically a good thing. But if your daughter can't do that, he'll kill her. He's done it again. He's done it before, and he's willing to do it again. And with that, we leave the wicked and warped world of the Duke of Ferrara. Okay. That's it.